The first of our speakers in the next session is known as the Content Czarina and was recently honored with the prestigious Padma Shri Award. She has been the backbone of the entertainment industry.
Well, our second guest now is a global healthcare leader, entrepreneur, humanitarian, and an all-round role model for women. She is constantly revolutionizing the healthcare system and accelerating positive acceleration to provide universal access to healthcare. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together and let me invite the Dynamo Ladies, Joint MD of Apollo Hospitals, Ms. Sangeeta Reddy, and the Managing Director, Balaji Telefilms, Ms. Ekta Kapoor, for a panel discussion on how women will lead India's growth mission with our own powerhouse, the consulting editor, Politics for Times Now, Padmita Joshi.
Can you have a big round of applause, please?
Thank you very much. Right at the outset, I want to first start by asking you, Dr. Reddy, is it annoying to be known as a woman entrepreneur, a woman business person, a woman this? Is that annoying? Is this reductive?
It should be a compliment, right? But no. I think the label is typically unnecessary. If you look at women in a certain socioeconomic group. But the focus on acknowledging that women are capable, that there's a tremendous need across society to enhance women's labor participation, to improve the gender gap, all these are, you know, stark realities on the ground. And therefore, I don't let any such labeling or titles bother me. I just think they're one step towards focusing that women can do everything in the workplace that a man can do, and therefore there should be enhanced participation of women in every sphere of life.
Ekta, since we're talking about, first let's identify the problems and then we'll talk about how women are going to address those problems and drive the growth story. So being a woman, content creator, filmmaker, are there any special skills which you think hold you in good stead, which are actually an added bonus where men in the same position would perhaps be at a disadvantage?
So it is subjective, because if you take television, it is a skill because you land up knowing it's a female narrative, you know. So you land up knowing far better because it's something that comes naturally. And my men have to cultivate the understanding of female mind. But in films, it's a male narrative mostly. So we have to cultivate the art of knowing how men think. Unfortunately, these are very, very big demarcations. And we constantly break it because we're making films for women now. And there's also television for men. So yes, and no. So there is no special skill. There's special skill in life, which I would say the art of multitasking. I think I take my three-year-old to school, from school to office, and I am usually at times playing with him while giving a narration. So I think that's a skill women naturally develop, multitasking.
But very interesting thing. As a follow-up, I want to ask you, since you brought up the issue of, you know, the male gaze and how the films largely function through the male gaze, how did you cut through that? How did you manage to crack that formula? And I think we can safely say you have, given your success. How did you do it?
Because I think I don't look at life or content with a male or a female gaze. But if I'm making a story which is about men, I channelize the inner alpha man in me and play it out. I mean, I think you have to be fluid that way in life. You know, you can't think of yourself as a woman, I can only think of these things. Or as a man, I can only, you have to live life like humans. And you know, you sometimes celebrate your, you know, male characters as much as you celebrate your female characters, you know. So you live out your various aspects with various characters. You don't contain yourself and say, okay, this is all I can do. And I need to have a male gaze to look at a, I made Shoot Out at Wadala and I made Once Upon a Time in Mumbai, the first few gang dramas in India. And I was like, why can't I make them? Why should I only make films for women, being a woman?
Dr. Reddy, we are talking at a time where we've had quite a few revolutionary last few years. I remember, and this may be an unpopular opinion, but we had a huge Me Too movement in our country. Then we had the maternity leave, which was increased. After that, there was a point where there was a lot of conversation in the workplace where, maybe not overtly, but covertly it was being questioned, are women actually a liability? There would be the odd joke that said, arre, ab toh hum sab pe Me Too ho jayega. Now we can't even smile at women. If we crack jokes, she will say that, you know, I have been Me Too'd or something like that. How do you get beyond that and still drive the growth model for the future?
So this is a deep one, but I think it's an important question. To begin with, I think we just need to improve the ratio of women at work. Very interestingly, at Apollo, we have 57% of our workforce is women, and all of you may automatically think, ah, there are lots of nurses, therefore, but it's not the case. Even in the corporate levels, we have a significant number of women. So when the workforce equalizes, the chance for these type of singling out of women, negative behavior minimizes. So that's point number one. But going a bit deeper into that one comment you made on the you know, the pregnancy benefit. Are women a liability? I really appreciated the fact that the government made a regulation which said that the pregnancy leave should get enhanced, and I think it went from 12 to 24 weeks. And that was a good thing, because this is society recognizing that women have this tremendous responsibility as they bring a child in, and they should not be disadvantaged. But when reality hit, the fact is that future employers look at future employees and say, "Ha, she's 25, she's going to have a baby. At that time, I have to pay for 6 weeks of her not being here." What I would now like is to propose that it's 12 weeks of women's getting the paid leave and another 12 weeks of optional for men or women. Maybe the husband would like to stay at home and help with the baby because he's the father too. So how do we change the narrative, change the lens, that it's not just the woman's responsibility and therefore we have to protect her, but it's a joint responsibility of society and of the parents, and therefore we must create an enabling framework and an ecosystem to build this equality. And so I'm not, you know, acknowledging the fact that it's there. We have to acknowledge, appreciate and understand that in this diverse country, there will be many, many situations. There are going to be the great employers and there are going to be the people who think in this manner. There are going to be the outstanding fathers who say, let me find a way to share half the, I'm not going to say burden, let me share half the responsibility. So I just think that all of us must consciously build a framework of equal responsibility and equal participation.
When we talk about women having a greater participation, does a woman being at the head of affairs make it more inclusive if you're at the top? Because when men are at the top, they have a wolf pack, right? The boss gets ahead, everyone gets ahead. Does it also apply to when a woman is the chief?
So, I started very young, so I had all these things I had to deal with, like being a woman was one, being young was the other, and being so-called star kid, not taken seriously, was the third. But what I interestingly found was the big boys club exists everywhere. It is not a lie. It is there. It's natural, I would say, for men to have an instant affinity to their tribe. They can't crack jokes when women are around. So you automatically tend to hang with each other and probably have a drink with each other, and that creates a proximity that women are not don't have an access to. It was something I had seen through my life. But that's why I feel representation is very important and women bosses are very important, because when you've gone through it, you don't want to subject anyone through it. There's a natural sisterhood too, but you live beyond it. Personally, I feel having a kid made me far more understanding towards women who are mothers. I mean, I have a small crèche in my office, and when somebody tells me they have to run home because their son is unwell, I know the feeling, you know. It's a very identifiable thought process. It's a fear that, you know, I can immediately, like, oh, please check. Oh, there's a hand, foot, mouth disease I didn't know about, and now I get to know that this is a fear. When somebody had that fear, I got the same fear. And I'm a hypochondriac, as man knows, so it's a bigger problem. But the understanding becomes far more easy when you have representation of women and in chairs and in positions, because the identification of the problem is more there. So I sometimes feel I maybe misunderstood the big boys club, because maybe that understanding is natural when a man has an issue and he tells the other guy, they both probably share a back slapping moment, and I should not have such a problem because now I have that with so many women in my office. They can sit there and be like, shit, you know, headache, this, that, you know. I mean, so much understanding comes with your gender, and then you learn to live beyond it too.
But do you see that natural affinity playing out the same way that Ekta spoke of the boys club? Has that affinity developed in the workplace, or there is also the other stereotype where once a woman gets into the league, she somehow has to become a bigger boy than the biggest boy, and because the other women may not naturally progress? How have you seen that play out?
Let me assure you, these two women are not playing that stereotype. But, you know, again, I want to change the narrative. These are things that women felt forced they had to do because they were in a minority. They wanted to, it was easier to be identified and be like the guys because your tribe was not big enough to have its own personality. But this evolution is happening, this change is happening, the knowledge economy is going to be one of the biggest levelers for women. At a time when in manufacturing you needed strength, when there was no safety on the roads, you know, women couldn't go out. We were speaking about this instance where because of digital payments and the pervasiveness of digital payments, women entrepreneurs now don't have to worry about collecting their cash. Imagine she's a fruit vendor. She doesn't have to collect her cash and walk to the bank worried about what to do with her money. Or maybe not go to the bank, but carry it to buy the next day's vegetables. These kind of things are changing with digital payments. The knowledge economy is changing. The work, you know, work from home, artificial intelligence, IoT. In this environment of changing needs of the workforce, changing nature of jobs, enhancing number of women in entrepreneurial, and the big one is that smart companies are realizing that women are in fact the largest influencers of purchasing decisions. While they may directly be a consumer of about, I think it's 24 billion or something, but they influence almost double that. 43 billion worth of purchasing is influenced by women. So considering that fact, I think the whole world, or the whole savvy smart world, is getting more women oriented, or women, and this is a phrase that we created or brought about when I was president Fiki, we started an initiative called the Greater 50. Because while women made up 49% of the population, their impact was greater than 50. Because their impact is not just in their number, but it's in the soft side of life. It's in the environment side. It's in social consciousness. So anyway, just quickly, what we wanted to convey is a new terminology, and that is gender intelligence. It's not gender bias, it's not me too, it's just gender intelligence. And intelligent societies and intelligent corporations and equal participation makes for a better world. And that's the world we need to strive for.
Can you explain how gender intelligence manifests itself in day-to-day life in the workplace?
So very simple, the corporate checklist had things from, do you have bathrooms for women? It's as basic. If a woman feels that she is being inappropriately treated, what is the redressal mechanism to make this change? It is systems and processes in place. It's an awareness that some of these situations may be happening, and a proactive correction mechanism. And then it goes on. I mean, like all of us understand that we need to be friendly to different types of environments. So, you know, is this building handicap friendly? So is this building women friendly? Does an airport have a special section for mothers, you know, new mothers? These are checklists that you put into place. The creche that Ekta spoke about. There are many things which just signal that we are women friendly. And women friendly organizations will get a better employment record, will have lower attrition, and have more commitment at the workplace than those who are being oblivious of this reality of gender intelligence.
How did that gender intelligence translate into the audience facing? For example, the content that you create, what you do in the office, for example, the creche. That's one example. It's inward looking. But outward looking, how did you bring in this gender intelligence?
So you just know that half the population is women, you know. It's just the... So you can't only cater to the male psychology. And I think when we started television, it was interesting because everyone was in shock that television suddenly became about Tulsi and Parvati. And while a lot of people thought it was about a woman who's dressing up and looking her best, actually a lot of research that was carried out on India at that time, social research, said that women started participating in their home activities after that. I mean, all our heroines at that time were like wearing the sari, looking extremely relatable and aspirational. So she wore the sari like any other typical Indian housewife, like in the most degrading term as they would put it. But she wore jewelry, she looked her best, which was aspirational. And this combination, she went ahead and had the same issues that probably most women had. A lot of people in the cities didn't identify with that. But kitchen politics was a reality. It was somebody's reality. That's why they identified with it. And yet she took the call that whenever she had to take a stand, she did. And suddenly we realized that television was creating this voice. Now, even though we go into the masses and we have these good girls and bad girls, and it's eventually a story about women. The large arc is that there are lots of women who found their voice through television. I feel more and more as we are creating content, and the more I'm realizing, and this is an earlier story now, is that gender intelligence in the audiences says that it should come in the content makers. And it has to be a smart way of telling entertaining stories and not these really classy, elitist stories, because we are giving gender intelligence to the intelligent. Matlab ki, there is no difference. I mean, if I'm sitting in a film festival and seeing something really eclectic, then I'm not really doing anything big. I'm just making it relatable to that audience. So when we did Dirty Picture, I thought that was my biggest. I took a story, I made it entertaining, I got the masses in. There was a lot of sexuality, but there was a woman owning it. She didn't have an issue because she stood out there and said, this is me, I am sexy, and sex dekhte aap sab hai aur dirty main. And suddenly when we saw a theater clap, we realized that that mass was synthesized towards understanding that, okay, we played her like this, in cliche terms, hero, and actually told her story in an entertaining way, and somewhere changed a little bit of that mindset. I feel if we start doing that, and we're doing that a lot more, like I'm planning to do a couple of films like that, because if you make it entertaining, then you subconsciously get into the human mind. If you become preachy, then you become elitist and you get rejected by the masses, and that's something I do not want to do. So that's the idea of getting suspension of reality, putting swish pans, entertaining music, and slowly getting into the subconscious.
So you don't have to preach to the choir. It's not a little clique that you're talking to. You're seeding that idea. A final question that I want to ask you, Dr. Reddy, is about, if we are talking about two major action points that are needed from here on. We have government intervention, we've got government programs about, you know, female infanticide, etc. But as a society, corporate, filmmakers, two action points for the near foreseeable future.
Okay. So corporates, I think, just an awareness that women are the large untapped resource. And 430 million women in, you know, potentially who could be in the workforce. And if we want India to be this $5 trillion, $6 trillion economy, it is only by unleashing the power of women in addition to men that we will make the growth numbers that we're looking at. So an appreciation of the power of women and finding a way, whichever it is that way, you know, women-friendly workforce. So one is that appreciation that we must have equal participation is clearly one of them. And the other is the longer term and is already starting, but clearly education, and education is not just at the school level. You may have graduated 5 years ago, but if you want to pick up a career in artificial intelligence, it's not too late to do so. Just understanding that the exponential world is upon us. Web 3.0, AI, all these are changing at a pace which is unimaginable. And it is for us to seize that moment and use this as the great leveler, which therefore contributes to society.
And maybe there'll be a day when we'll sit here and say, how can professionals drive the growth story and not about women professionals or male professionals? In that fond hope, thank you very much, both ladies, for having joined me. Thank you.
Thank you so much.